Hello, students. We're now going to talk about 4.1, which deals with probability theory. Later on in another video, we'll cover 4.2, so we're in packet unit 7. First, we'd like to talk about the man who discovered, or we'll say helped co-create probability theory. His name is Blaise Pascal. French mathematician. He was approached by a gambler at the time period and was asked, the gambler wanted to know if it was possible for him to increase his winnings. This led to discussions with other mathematicians, and the foundations for probability theory was laid down. Now, probability theory is used in a wide range of areas, the insurance industry to measure risk, biological research for genetics and other areas. And stock market analytics, just to make once again measuring risk on equities and other types of investments. The definition for probability basically just represents the chance that an event will occur. Okay, so that's what we're measuring in a numerical sense. Now, there are three types of probabilities that are studied: classical, empirical, and subjective. We will focus on what's called classical probability. This assumes that every probability has an equal chance of occurring. So an example would be to toss one die. Remember, die is singular for dice. What that means is each side of the die has one out of six chances of occurring because the die has six sides if you're working with a standard die. Empirical probability, that's computed by performing experimentation. Let's say a biologist wants to reduce the chance that a desert tortoise will be run over by a vehicle to preserve that wonderful species. So what he does is the biologist may, there's no formula that he can turn to on a specific road. The only way of measuring this probability is through observation, experimentation with the vehicles going by, and then eventually he might come up with an estimated value that he might be able to use in a research grant to construct some means for the tortoises to avoid that road. But empirical probabilities, we're not going to really focus on in this class. Remember, it's those type of probabilities are performed by experimentation. We also have subjective probability. Subjective probability is based on professional experience. It has no real mathematics involved. This would be the example where a doctor tells a patient they have a 20% chance of getting sick with the flu. That's just a professional judgment. It doesn't involve any mathematics. So we are now going to look at some of the key definitions. The first definition is a probability experiment. That's a process that leads to well-defined results called outcomes. One example is you toss one coin. Okay, so that's a basic example. Another example would be you toss one die. We mentioned it, the die previously. The sample space, that's the set of all possibilities for a probability experiment. So if you write down the sample space, so when you toss one coin, you have two possibilities, heads or tails. And then when you have one die, you can write down the sample space there. You have six possibilities, one through six. An event is the number of outcomes of a probability experiment. So, for example, if we want to measure the chance of getting tails, well, the event would just be T for tails. An event for getting an even number would be the following outcomes: 2, 4, 6, because we only focus on the even numbers. So, once, as I, let me just mention that these values, you can write them down. Some sample spaces may be too large to write down. You just want to be aware of the number of items in that sample space. So now let's look at calculating probabilities. So to calculate probabilities, we're going to use this formula here. It's basically the number of outcomes in the event divided by the number of outcomes in the sample space. So to calculate the chance of getting tails, well, there's only one tails out of two possibilities, so p is 1/2. And then to calculate the chance of getting an even number, well, we have three even numbers out of six possibilities, which reduces to 1/2. We want to reduce all fractions. So that's going to lead to one of our basic rules. All probabilities should be written as a reduced fraction or a decimal rounded to three place values or a percent. So remember to convert a decimal to a percent, move the decimal spot or decimal point two spaces to the right, write in the percent. To convert a fraction to a decimal, divide 3 into 2. Another basic rule is that probabilities are bounded by two values, 0 on the left side, 1 on the right side. So the minimum value that a probability can have is 0. Let's go back to the example with the die. Let's say we wanted to measure the chance of getting a 10 when you toss a standard die. Not possible. The maximum value is 6. So 0 is a probability when an event like that occurs. 1 means the probability will occur all the time. So if you toss one die, what is the chance that that you will get a number that's larger than 0 when you toss one die? Well, all the numbers are larger than 0. So think of 1 as representing 100% chance. Now we're going to focus on two dice. Okay, so if we have two dice, the outcomes are a little bit more complicated. So remember, each side of the die, one die has six sides. So 6 times 6 leads to 36 outcomes. So when you toss two dice, the sample space has 36 outcomes. And typically when we toss our dice, we add the sides together. So we're looking for the sum of all the dots to get our outcome. Let's take a look at an example. So for example, let's say that we want to find the sum of 5. So we're going to count the number of ways of getting a sum of 5 for two dice. How we'll do this is, since we're kind of limited here, we're going to use ordered pairs. The value in the first ordered pair is the first die. The value in the second ordered pair is the second die. So it turns out there's 4 ways of getting a sum of 5. 1, 4, 2, 3, 3, 2, and 4, 1. And I've also provided you with the following sample space. So this is basically listing all the ways that we can get the outcomes of two dice. So for example, a 2, there's 1 way, a 3, there's 2 ways. So just think of the blue and white dice as representing different pairs of dice. So 4 would be 1, 2, and 3 ways of getting a 4. So going back to this example, so there's 4 ways of getting a sum of 5. So it's 4 out of 36. You reduce by 4, you get 1/9. And so there is a table that I wrote. This kind of just is a numerical representation of the previous table that I showed you, just showing you that there's a pattern. So if you want to get a sum of 2, there's 1 way. So sum of 2 is called snake eyes. So there's 1 way of getting a sum of 2. And the pattern, it just increases by 1 until you get to the sum of 7. Sum of 7 has the maximum number of outcomes, 6, and then it counts down afterwards by 1. So just to do one more example involving two dice, let's say we want to compute the probabilities of getting a sum of 7. Well, we just look at 7. There's 6 ways of getting a sum of 7. Remember, out of 36 possibilities, so if you add up all the entire frequencies, there's 36 possibilities. So that's going to be, and then that reduces to 1 out of 6. So the probability of getting a sum of 7, 1 out of 6. We're going to introduce the concepts of cards, but before we do that, just make sure you pause the video and work out these problems here. And let's now move on to the deck of cards. We're just going to keep in mind that although each deck comes with two jokers, we're going to exclude them from the deck. There's 52 cards. Half the cards are red, half are black. There's four suits: diamonds, clubs, hearts, and spades. We have four aces. We have a number of numbered cards, and we have 12 face cards. So this is our sample space. You'll have, once again, on the form, the sample space sheet I passed out, you'll have access to the sample space for the cards. So let's just take a look at a couple of examples involving cards. So let's say we want to calculate the chance of getting an ace. Well, there's four aces out of 52 cards. That reduces to 1 out of 13. Let's say we want to compute the chance of getting a king and a red card. Well, when you see the word and, think of and as representing the card will have both properties. So we're looking really for a red king. Well, there's two red kings. So the chance is 2 out of 52, which reduces to 1 out of 26. And then let's work out the fourth example. Jack or a diamond, when you see the word or, think of adding. So first let's count the number of jacks. There's four jacks. So for the jacks, it's the chance is 4 out of 52. Now let's look at the diamonds. There's 13 diamonds. That's 13 out of 52. But there's a problem here. We have four jacks and 13 diamonds. We're overcounting the jacks by one. So we should subtract out one of the jacks so we don't overcount. We get 16 out of 52. The final result is 4 out of 13. Pause the video and work out these other problems. And then finally, we have three other problems for you to try on your own. So this video will stop here to give you a chance to work in these problems. Later on, I'll post the answers. But for now, just try to work out these problems. Go to the discussion board if you have questions. Contact some fellow students if you need to. But just work on these problems for now. And we'll continue with the next video.